Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of The Ocean of Knowledge with me, your host Ahmed Ali. Now in tonight's episode, just like the other previous episodes, we have been rejoicing and celebrating the birth anniversary of our fifth Imam, seventh infallible Imam Muhammad bin Ali Al-Baqir, peace and blessings be upon him. Now in the previous episodes, for the dear viewers who are just tuning in for the first time, we have been talking about, in the first episode we talked about a little bit of the life events that Imam Al-Baqir went through and his worship, his supplications. You can visit our YouTube channel to view that episode. And in yesterday's episode, we talked about the title of Al-Baqir, and we talked about his relationship with Jabir ibn Abdullah Al-Ansari and who he was. Now this was discussed with my dear guest, Sayid Hussein Al-Qazwini, who is joining us once again in tonight's episode. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina.
Alaikum assalam.
Allah khalikum, inshaAllah. How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Allah khalikum. I would like to congratulate you as well as congratulate our dear viewers on this very auspicious occasion.
Thank you very
which
much.
Marks the birth anniversary of this great individual, Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. Now, yesterday we talked about Jabir, and we talked about how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam introduced Jabir decades before to Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. He told him, you know, he prophesied of who he was, you know, to live along. And he gave a brief explanation of what Al-Baqir meant. This will lead into what we're going to talk about. He says, Al-Baqir will introduce, spread, and open up knowledge, just like the ground when it opens up for cultivation. Now, with this being said, you know, a person who spreads, splits, and, you know, shares the amount of knowledge that Imam Al-Baqir al-Islam shared, what was his role? You know, did he spread the knowledge in a certain way, or was it, you know, following the commands of Allah? You know, for the, there's various ways that he taught him.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين. When we examine the lives of the Ahlul Bayt, we see that there were various stages. For example, beginning with Imam Ali alayhi salam, Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein, this was the early stage of Shi'ism. The Ahlul Bayt had not fully introduced Shi'ism, but were rather fighting foreign agents that were about to destroy Islam. Imam Ali alayhi salam had to deal with various groups like Muawiyah at the Battle of Safin.
Khawarij.
He had to deal with the Khawarij that were also trying to distort the image of Islam. He had to deal with the people of Al-Jamal, who included one of the wives of the Prophet and two of his companions. Islam was being distorted. Imam Ali had to try to save the image of Islam. Same goes for Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam.
Yes.
Imam al-Hassan had to deal with a conniving, deceitful person like Muawiyah, who was making use of Islam for personal agendas and personal reasons. And Imam al-Hussein had to deal with the son of Muawiyah,
Yazid.
Now, this was a stage where Islam was under attack, not from outside, but from within. The image of Islam was being distorted. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi had put Islam on certain tracks. There were others that tried to put Islam on another track, to deviate it from that track. It was the job of the early Imams, and to some degree Imam Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam, to steer the direction back to the way that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi had planned. Of course, Allah had planned through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Did the early Imams, like Imam Ali, Imam al-Hassan, Imam al-Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin, were they able to show the specific details about the ideology, about the theology, about the jurisprudence of Shi'ism? No, not really. They didn't get a chance. Their time was a time of correction, correcting the mistakes of the Khalafa, correcting the mistakes of those that tried to steer Islam to a different direction. But did they have a platform to come and speak and teach and show the tenets of Islam, show the tenets of Shi'ism, give the specific details. They didn't. They didn't get a chance. This gave way to a new beginning, to a new stage. And that stage began with Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam and Imam Sadiq to a more degree, to a bigger degree. Imam Al-Baqir, during the time of Imam Al-Baqir, we see a shift from, from the defensive to the offensive, if we want to put it in plain terms. From defending the reputation of Islam to giving the details of Islam, giving details about the school of thought of Ahlul Bayt, what their school of thought is all about, their jurisprudence. Up till the time of Imam Zain al-Abidin, people saw the Ahlul Bayt as pious men, those men who stood for justice, who stood against oppression, spiritual men, especially Imam Zain al-Abidin, men known for their prayers, for their acts of worship, for their dua. But what is their school of thought all about? Is it just about fighting oppression and shedding blood, sacrificing for the sake of Islam? Is it only about spirituality and reciting dua? Is that it?
Mm-hmm.
Or is Shi'ism much deeper than that?
Yeah.
It has an intellectual basis. It has it has its own jurisprudence. Mm-hmm. It has its own legal theory. It has its own theology. It has its own tafsir of the Holy Quran. These were all exponents that were not clear during the days of the early imams. These factors were shown in the life of Imam Al-Baqir and Imam Sadiq. Imam Al-Baqir was able to sit inside Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi in Medina and show the true meaning of Shi'ism. Intellectually.
Mm-hmm.
Intellectually. What is Shi'ism all about? It's about the justice of Allah. Al-Adl. Al-Nubuwa.
Mm-hmm.
Al-Imama. Imam Al-Baqir was able to show what Imama is. What is the meaning of Imama? An Imam is an infallible Imam that never commits a sin, that has to have knowledge, that is divinely educated. He's not educated at schools. Nubuwa. What is Nubuwa? What is prophecy? Prophet has to be infallible, and so on and so forth. Al-Qiyamah, Yawm al-Ma'ad, Resurrection, the Day of Judgment. These were all ideas introduced by Imam al-Baqir in theology.
Mm-hmm.
When we come to jurisprudence, Imam al-Baqir showed the jurisprudence of Ahlul Bayt. The Ahlul Bayt were not just pious people that sacrificed their life, that lived simple lives, but no, they had knowledge. They had jurisprudence. They understood the detailed laws of Islam. How to pray, how to worship, how to fast, how to perform Hajj, how to marry, how to divorce, the contracts, business, how to perform business. The Ahlul Bayt carried laws
mm-hmm.
that was passed on to them from Imam to Imam, from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, divinely educated knowledge,
mm-hmm.
divinely received knowledge from Allah.
Mm-hmm.
This was his chance to educate. This doesn't mean that the previous imams did not educate. They educated, but they did not have the platform
like that Imam Al-Baqir did.
Yes, Imam Ali alayhi salam did educate, but not to all. He chose specific companions to educate, like Salman, like Abu Dharr, like Al-Miqdad, Mithim al-Tamar. He had a small group. Why? Because other companions were not up to the bar. They were not capable. Imam al-Baqir saw that he could educate bigger numbers than his forefathers did, than Imam Ali, Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein did. Thus he was able to educate.
Mm-hmm.
When Imam al-Baqir, when Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam came, he had a bigger platform.
Yes.
He had even a bigger platform. So his number one role, it was not a military opposition to the government. He was not trying to overthrow the government. He was not trying to start a political party. No. His main role was educational. An educational role to show the details of the school of thought.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's actually, the way you mentioned it, linking it to Ahlul Bayt alayhim from the previous imams, because a lot of people do wonder, where were the imams before him? I mean, jurisprudence, you know, the idea of jurisprudence began or was initiated
from Imam Al-Baqir.
From Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. And a lot of people, it's unfortunate that they don't give credit to Imam Al-Baqir as much as they give credit to Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. A lot of people, when they mention the Ja'fari school of thought, well, it's actually initiated by Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, who began that university, who began that, you know, because a lot of people that he taught, but as you mentioned, the floor was open to Imam Sadiq more than it was open to Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam.
And it was open to Imam Al-Baqir more than the other imams.
More than the other imams.
It was, you know, political events play a major role.
A huge role.
Right now in Iraq, we have a major hawza. In Karbala alone, we have over 1,000 hawza students.
Wow.
During the days of Saddam, there was no hawza. So what changed? The political circumstances.
Definitely.
They changed. So too in Najaf. In Najaf, there was a hawza, but it was very minor during the days of Saddam.
Yeah.
After the fall of Saddam, hawza came back as it was before. Now there's teachers, there's classes, there's lessons. Political circumstances play a major role in the spread of knowledge. And that's what occurred during the days of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam.
And especially when the imams have to defend religion at the same time, you know, at the time of spreading it. You know, we see Imam Hussein spreading Islam through his sacrifice.
Ahsan.
And same way Imam Ali ibn Talib spread Islam
during
through
the days
his own
of
ways.
During the days of Imam Ali, Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein, people were not ready for intellectual
they were deviated.
Discussions. They were deviated. Islam in itself was under... you know, danger.
Yeah,
Islam was in danger, let alone the details.
Definitely.
They were not ready for the details. Islam was being was put into danger. There was a Khalifa that would drink publicly. He would commit adultery publicly. He would gamble publicly. This was the face of Islam.
Yeah.
Imam Hussein had to correct this.
Definitely.
Imam Zain al-Abidin went a step further. He introduced spirituality to Islam because people had surpassed that stage of the dangerous stage. They needed spirituality because all they saw from Bani Umayyah was spending lavishly. They lived a lavish lifestyle, their castles, their mansions, their alcohol, their money, their harems, their mistresses. They were taking Muslims away from spirituality. Yeah. Imam Zain al-Abidin brought them back to spirituality. Up to the time of Imam al-Baqir, when Imam al-Baqir became the imam, then he saw people were ready to receive jurisprudence, the details about Islamic laws.
Yes, and that's actually perfect. And as you mentioned, he did teach a lot of people. So he had that reputation, which was really, of course, coming from the Ahl Bayt, alayhim as-salam, but the reputation of, you know, establishing something that has not been established yet. And a lot of it does go to Imam Al-Baqir, alayhi as-salam, but yet no one recognizes that.
If I may comment about this. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam might not have been known personally. People knew him, but not everyone knew him, right? But everyone knew that he came from a line of imams. This is the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib, and the son of Imam Al-Hassan, and the son of Imam Al-Hussein, and the son of Imam Zain al-Abidin. There was a family reputation.
Yeah.
And this helped him.
Definitely.
Imam Al-Baqir inherited this great family reputation that gave him credit, that gave him the support to be able to teach. While if it was someone else who was not known, nor his family was known, it would have been extremely difficult for him to come and establish himself in the Islamic Ummah as whom? As a teacher.
Yeah.
As a teacher, as an instructor. It would have been very difficult for him. But Imam Al-Baqir had the benefit of inheriting this family heritage, and family inheriting this family name, this family reputation. He was able to work. Just like today. Today we see some individuals here in Iraq or in other places.
Yeah.
They inherited the family name.
You see people, we see that.
They follow him. They follow them. Or specific individuals. Why? Because they inherited that reputation from their fathers, from their forefathers. And so too was Imam Al-Baqir. He inherited this name of scholars, of pious men, self-sacrificing, spiritual men. And this helped him spread the message of Ahlul Bayt in the Islamic nation.
Now, during the time of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, we also see the rise of Sunni scholars, and you know the government at that time, you know, saw the threat of Imam Al-Baqir, want to raise awareness to the people, but didn't treat him like they treated the previous imams, his forefathers. So they went in a different way where they began to, you know, spend money on scholars to try and combat Ahl Bayt alayhim salam through marja'iyat al-sahaba and ijtihad. Al-ra'i, if you will, like the ijtihad that on based on my own opinion.
Personal opinion,
like we see later on with Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam. But did Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam face any problems with that? I mean, we do see him saying something that is not, you know, not normal from, you know, it's like he's giving own legislations and own laws instead of saying, you know what, this is from Imam Zain al-Abidin, and you know, the chain of command, if you will.
Right.
So we don't see that with Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. Why is that?
Right. You see, up to the time of Imam al-Baqir, there was a political problem.
Mm-hmm.
And that problem was that the Khilafah, instead of coming to Imam Ali and the Ahl al-Bayt, it went to some of the Sahaba.
Yeah.
But up till then, it was purely a political problem. It was purely a political problem that the Sahaba were in power. Instead of having the Ahl al-Bayt be in power, power shifted from the Ahl al-Bayt to the Sahaba.
Yeah.
But was this legitimized? No, it wasn't legitimized. Well, there were Sahaba in power, that's it. Then, during the time of Imam al-Baqir, we see that no, the Sahaba didn't just have political power, they started gaining religious power.
Yeah.
That this is the school of Sahaba. Before, there was no school of Sahaba.
No.
It was just the Sahaba were in power, and you have to respect them. That's it. You have to respect their authority. Now, the Sahaba were given religious authority. This is the school of Sahaba. And to confront who? The school of
Ahl
al-Bayt. Because if it was only the school of Ahl al-Bayt, and there was no one to compete with that school, they would attract the entire Muslim nation.
Yeah.
And to attract them as religious followers, that would get them to power.
Definitely.
When you have everyone following you in religion, matters of religion, that will, people will automatically say, well, if we're following them in matters of religion, shouldn't they be the ones in power? So there had to be another school of thought to combat that. And that school of thought was called Madrasat al-Sahaba. It was in that period.
Who established that?
It was not an individual.
Uh-huh.
It became something common.
So was it political? Like what I mean was,
well,
was it funded by the caliph of the time?
Yeah, it was. It was blessed by the political authorities.
Mm-hmm.
That now there's the school of the Sahaba. And this school of Sahaba, it produced the likes of Abu Hanifa,
wow,
Malik ibn Anas, Al-Shafi'i, Ahmad ibn Hanbal.
Mm-hmm.
It was these jurists that carried out, the, you know, they publicized for the school of Sahaba. So this is this is one problem. Another problem that Imam al-Baqir faced was that now that he's spreading knowledge, now that he's teaching, now that he's giving, he's showing the jurisprudential school of thought of Ahl al-Bayt, how is he doing this? Abu Hanifa, of course Abu Hanifa came after Imam al-Baqir. He was one of the students of Imam Sadiq. But there were other jurists at the time of Imam al-Baqir. People like Abu Hanifa, Malik ibn Anas, they would claim that they're mujtahids. They look at the teachings of the Quran, the Sunnah of Rasulullah, the Sunnah of the Sahaba, as they call it, and they give their own opinion, right? They didn't claim that this is God's law.
Mm-hmm.
That I'm a jurist, and I'm giving you my opinion. Imam al-Baqir, obviously, he's not a jurist. Imam al-Baqir was not a mujtahid. It's not like he was looking at the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah, mm-hmm, and he was deriving laws.
Yeah.
What he said was a law itself. What the sayings of Imam al-Baqir were God's commands. It's not that he was trying to understand God's commands. There's, mm-hmm, a difference,
yeah,
between someone who reveals God's commands
and who studies it,
and someone who tries to study God's commands.
Yeah.
What others did, they were studying God's commands and giving their opinion. Mm-hmm. Imam Al-Baqir did not do that. Imam Al-Baqir, out of, you know, we believe he's the Ahlul Bayt, have the right to legislate. Mm-hmm. And what they legislate is God's command. How is he supposed to relate this to the Muslims? And this posed a question. Mm-hmm. Because whenever Imam Al-Baqir spoke, right? Whenever Imam Al-Baqir spoke, he would say, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ
Right away?
Right away. Mm-hmm. And this, people were shocked. Mm-hmm. How do you know Rasulullah said this?
Exactly.
How do you know Rasulullah said this? Because others, when they would narrate, they would say, I heard from this person, and this person heard from that person, from this person, from this person, that Rasulullah said. They would take it back to the Sahaba. Meaning, whatever we've heard from Rasulullah, it was through whom?
The Sahaba.
The Sahaba. Imam Al-Baqir would surpass the Sahaba. He wouldn't mention the names of the Sahaba. He would go directly to Rasulullah. Now, this was frowned upon, that you are bypassing the Sahaba. You are putting yourself not just, you know, in the position of the Sahaba, but even greater than the Sahaba. You're going directly to Rasulullah and saying that Rasulullah said this and this. Mm-hmm. There's a narration. Do we have to take a break?
Can we go take a break and then come back? Absolutely. Inshallah, we'll come back to that narration. Respected viewers, do stay tuned for after the break for we'll inshallah continue our discussion revolving around how was the first school of thought established by Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam. That's after the break, so stay tuned. Respected viewers, once again, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to the second part of today's episode. Now, before we begin, I would like to congratulate you on a special occasion which marks the birth anniversary of Imam Muhammad Al-Baqir, peace and blessings be upon him. Now, before the break, we did touch upon how the others tried to combat the school of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, through establishing another school of thought. Assalamu alaikum, Sayyidina, once again. Allah khaliikum. Now, can you a little bit recap about that? Just to clarify something?
Sure.
And then go into the narration you're about to talk about.
Right. Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam, his role was not just about spirituality, to teach people spirituality,
yes,
or to teach people about justice. You know, the lessons and morals that were taught by previous imams after him. No. He had an intellectual role.
Yes.
Now, this intellectual role was to show the laws of Islam. Mm-hmm. There were two ways. One is to say that this is my understanding of the laws of Islam through the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah and the Sunnah of the Sahaba, like other jurists at the time did. Or to come and say that this is the law, period. This is the law, period. This is how Rasulullah stated it. That's it. Mm-hmm. No questions asked. Don't ask me, you know, how did you derive this? Mm-hmm. Or how do you know that Rasulullah stated this? And this, you know, this put a question mark on Imam Al-Baqir. And he had to be very careful.
Yeah.
I had to be careful because Muslims were not used to someone who legislates laws right away. They were used to jurists that would tell them that we presumed this is how Rasulullah wanted things to be because we narrate from Rasulullah, right? So this put a question mark on how Imam Al-Baqir was going to deliver the laws. Mm-hmm. How is he going to teach? Is he going to teach as if the laws are from him? He's a representative of Allah? Or is he a jurist? You see?
Yeah.
One narration says that a man came to visit Imam Sadiq alayhi salam from, you know, not one of the Shia, not a follower of Ahl Bayt, from the other schools of thought.
Mm-hmm.
He came to visit Imam Al-Sadiq to offer his condolences after the death of Imam Al-Baqir. And then in the narration, he's disrespectful to Imam Al-Baqir. He says, عندما هلك أبو جعفر.
Wow.
هلك, it's not a polite term. You use it for those that, you know,
cause deviation. Or
cause deviation. You don't say it for good people.
Yeah.
Anyhow, he says, I came to visit Ja'far ibn Muhammad, al-Sadiq, and to give him my condolences
yeah.
on the death of his father. And he said, I told him, your father died. The one who would say قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ and would not ask how did you receive this narration قَالَ mm-hmm. رَسُولَ اللَّهِ what's your chain?
There's no in between.
The only one who would say قَالَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ and would not ask about the chain has died. I offer you my condolences. Imam Sadiq accepted the condolences and he thanked him and then he said قَالَ اللَّهِ.
Wow.
He said, basically saying that if you think my father would say قَالَ رَسُولَّهُ, I say قَالَ اللَّهُ. And I will not tell you what is my...
What's in between.
You see, people were not used to this.
Yeah.
Because they saw Imam Al-Baqir, Imam Sadiq as regular human beings, just like Abu Hanifa, just like Malik.
Yeah.
Those who need to say that this is my...
Who need to derive.
This is my, you know, my chain to Rasulullah. This shows that people were not used to the imams having legislative authority.
Mm-hmm. Does it not contradict the way that Imam Rida alayhi salam said, قَالَ أَبِي عَنْ جَدِّي عَنْ أَبِي عَنْ جَدِّي?
No, there's no contradiction. Sometimes Ahl al-Bayt, if they want to emphasize on something, they will mention the entire chain.
No, but jurisprudence needs a lot of emphasis.
Of course, it requires a lot of emphasis, but there's no reason to say he's lying. But sometimes, when do you mention a chain? When people doubt you.
Mm-hmm.
They might think you're lying. You say, no, I heard this from so-and-so, from so-and-so, from so-and-so. He saw it with his own eyes, right? Imam al-Rida, he said this where? In Nishabur.
Mm-hmm.
It was a Sunni city.
Mm-hmm.
They were all not followers of Ahl-Bayt.
But what I mean is, for example, even in the time of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, Shias were minorities. I mean, they're either persecuted or dead.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So he began that school of thought.
Right. Sometimes the Ahlul Bayt would mention the entire chain of narrators. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they don't even say qala. They immediately say halal, haram, do this, do that.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they would say qala Rasulullah.
Yeah.
Qala Rasulullah. Especially if the one asking the question was not one of their followers.
Mm-hmm.
So to tell him this is halal or that is haram, he might say, well, who are you to tell me that this is halal or that's haram? So they would put in what? Qala Rasulullah. To make the other person feel more comfortable in accepting this law.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned something that Imam al-Baqir was not like Malik ibn Anas or Abu Hanifa.
No, they were jurists.
They were jurists.
Imam al-Baqir was not a mujtahid.
So, for example, Abu Hanifa was a student of Imam al-Baqir.
Abu Hanifa was a student of Imam al-Sadiq.
He wasn't a student of Imam al-Baqir?
No.
Mm-hmm. Because, I don't know, some reason I read in a book that Abu Hanifa studied under Imam al-Baqir and Imam al-Sadiq.
Perhaps he might have met him.
Uh-huh.
Perhaps he might have met him, he might have spoken to him.
Mm-hmm.
But he was mainly the student of Imam al-Sadiq.
But
and for that reason, he stated لَوْلَ السَّنَةً لَهَلَكَ النُّعْمَانِ because of the 2 years that he studied under Imam Sadiq. Mm-hmm.
Now, what I mean by this is that since that these individuals tried to combat Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam, was there any conflict in between, or was it just a religious war, if you will, like a religious literature combat instead of a war happening?
There was no war. However, the Ahlul Bayt, especially Imam Al-Baqir and Imam Sadiq, mm-hmm. and we see this in the other Imams mm-hmm. after them. You see, up till Imam Zain al-Abidin, the Ahlul Bayt had not flexed their intellectual muscles, mm-hmm. right? The Ahlul Bayt, the people knew that Ahlul Bayt carried knowledge, but they hadn't seen it yet. Because Imam Ali had spent the 5 years that he was in power in battles. Yeah. He wasn't able to sit and give sermons and to give intellectual Perfect. Lectures. Same goes for Imam Al-Hassan, Imam Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin. When it came to Imam Al-Baqir, he was able to show the intellectual side mm-hmm. of Ahlul Bayt. The others did. I don't want anyone to misunderstand me. Yeah. The others did as well. But not like Imam Al-Baqir.
Through their actions.
Through their actions.
Imam Al-Baqir disseminated through his knowledge.
Yes. There was a process. There was a movement to mm-hmm. try to underestimate them.
Yes.
For example, the Khulafa, they purposely would bring top scholars to debate Imam Al-Baqir. This happened with Imam Al-Baqir. This happened with Imam Al-Sadiq. For example, Imam Al-Baqir met with the Pope, so to speak, mm-hmm. or the highest Christian authority. Mm-hmm. He met with the highest Jewish authority, Al-Jathuliq, so and so, in the narrations. Mm-hmm. He would meet with various schools of thought. Qutada from Basra. They would come and pose questions yes. to Imam Al-Baqir, the most difficult questions. Why? So that they lower he would him. Slip.
Yeah.
Perhaps out of the 10 or 20 questions posed to him, he might slip in one. Never. He would never slip. During the days of Imam Sadiq, in fact, during the days of Imam Sadiq, I believe Al-Mansur al-Dawaniqi would put Abu Hanifa to debate Imam Sadiq.
Wow.
His student, Imam Sadiq's student, Abu Hanifa, would try to debate Imam Sadiq to get him to slip. Never.
Never
it
happened.
Didn't happen. They had realized, the mm-hmm. Khulafa had realized that the Imams, specifically Imam Al-Baqir and Imam Sadiq, carried a lot of intellectual weight.
Mm-hmm.
And that's attractive. You know, to anyone, you see regular people, if you see someone carrying knowledge, you're immediately attracted to that person. And you would want to give authority to that person, yeah. even political authority. A person who carries knowledge, you would want that person to be in charge of you.
Yes.
And in charge of your country, in charge of your nation.
Definitely.
So the Khulafa wanted to underscore Imam Al-Baqir and Imam Sadiq to get attention away from them intellectually so that people would be deceived. Mm-hmm. But this
never happened.
Never happened. They mm-hmm. didn't succeed.
They didn't succeed. Now, currently, and even before when the Prophet preached Islam, there was a concept that played a role within spreading Islam. And right now, if someone wants to get his mission accomplished, or he has a goal in his mind, there's the aspect of taqiyya. Now, how did that play a role within the life of Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salam?
Imam Al-Baqir and Imam Sadiq had to be very careful in teaching, in spreading knowledge. Let me give you an example. It's like a religious speaker during the days of Saddam.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you cannot mention.
You have to be very careful.
Yeah.
You can't talk about politics. Whatever you talk about, they're going to think you're talking about Saddam. For example, we have to fight injustice.
Mm-hmm.
The authorities will think that what? You're calling people to fight yeah. Saddam. So being an orator, a religious orator, during the days of Saddam, or in any dictatorship, yeah. is very, very difficult. Imam Al-Baqir and Imam Sadiq were spreading knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And lecturing during the days of Bani Umayyah and Bani Al-Abbas.
Mm-hmm.
Very dangerous rulers.
Yeah.
So they had to be very careful not to insult the rulers. Or rather, not to instigate, not to insult. Insult is not the right, not the right word. Mm-hmm. But not to instigate them, not to stir them against the Shia. The Ahlul Bayt themselves, they were not afraid. They were not afraid for their lives. Whether they live or die, it didn't make a difference for them, the Ahlul Bayt. The Ahlul Bayt were not afraid of death. But they did care for the Shia.
They feared for the Shia.
They feared for the Shia. They didn't want to say anything that would put the Shia in danger. So to a certain degree, they had to practice taqiyah.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't want to instigate the other side. Mm-hmm. They didn't want to put themselves or their followers in danger. That's why, for example, if someone were to say, do you call for war? You'd have to say no. We don't call for war.
Mm-hmm.
They had to be very careful what they say, not to stir the other side.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they didn't have to say anything about the Khulafa, but they, for example, they couldn't voice their opinions in the presence of non-followers.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because this would get other scholars to feel threatened, and when other scholars feel threatened, they would make the Khulafa feel what? Threatened by the Ahl al-Bayt. So it was very tough times for the Imams. Very tough times.
Mm-hmm.
One, they have to spread knowledge and, you know, carry out their message. Mm-hmm. And two, not to offend. Not to offend, not to get themselves and their Shia in trouble. Mm-hmm. So they had to practice taqiyya, utmost taqiyya.
Mm-hmm. So to the most extent, if you
will. The most extent.
Mm-hmm. Now,
to a degree that Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam was forced to enter upon Al-Mansur Al-Dawaniqi, and he would have to say, As-salamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. To that degree.
Wow.
He had to call him Amir al-Mu'mineen. Why? Imam al-Sadiq was not afraid for himself. He was afraid not just for himself, but for his followers as well. They had to practice taqiyya.
Mm-hmm. Now, is this concept present in our days? Are we, you know, to a certain extent, forced to practice this, or are we free?
This is a controversy.
Mm-hmm.
Today, are we living at a time of taqiyya?
It does need a huge lecture by itself.
It has a lecture. Yeah. It needs a lecture by itself. But simply, what was the purpose of taqiyya?
Mm-hmm.
The purpose of taqiyya was for protection.
Yeah.
To protect the lives of the Shia and to protect the lives of Ahl al-Bayt.
Yes.
Now, does this apply today? Absolutely. In some places, you have to practice taqiyya. Imagine in some parts of the world now, I won't mention countries because it's obvious.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't practice taqiyya, your life will be in danger.
Yeah.
If you want to say everything that you know, everything that you were taught, you'll be in danger.
Yeah.
You will be in
your
danger.
Family.
Your family, your job, your wealth,
even
all of this.
Even people in other countries will be in danger because of that word that you say.
Ahsan, sometimes you are not in danger. You're living in a place where you will not be in danger, but your words will put others in
definitely
danger. Absolutely, this is a time of taqiyya.
Mm-hmm.
And I am of the opinion that we are still living in the times of taqiyya.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Inshallah. This by itself, as you mentioned, needs, you know, a lecture by itself to, you know, dissect into what matters we need taqiyya in and what matters we don't. But the last thing, we have the problem of ghulu. That, you know, it happens a lot. And we see many people,
especially during the life of Imam al-Baqir.
Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam. People, I don't know if they understood the actual meaning of this, or they just took it to another degree.
Very briefly, because
yes,
I know that we're running out of time.
Mm-hmm.
One of the problems that existed during the days of Imam al-Baqir, and this was an inside problem.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't with the Khulafa,
yeah.
It wasn't with another nation. No, it was within the Shi'i movement. There was a movement of the Khulaf. Basically, there were a group that claimed love for Ahlul Bayt is enough. You don't need to pray.
Yeah.
You don't need to fast.
Still exists.
It still exists till today.
Yeah.
You don't need to do any of these deeds. As long as you have love for Ahlul Bayt, you have the shafa'a of Ahlul Bayt, as long as you receive the intercession of Ahlul Bayt and you believe in them, in their wilayah, you have the wilayah of Ahlul Bayt, that is enough. This was very dangerous. This was a movement. It spread like wildfire. Why? Because it's easy telling people that all you need is love for Ahlul Bayt and you don't need to pray or fast. all you need to do is rely on the love of Ahl Bayt, you know, people would buy into this because it's easy. You don't need to pray anymore. You don't need to fast anymore. This was a problem faced by Imam Al-Baqir. Imam Al-Baqir had to be, you know, very strong. And we see some narrations, he would curse the ghulat and their leaders. May Allah curse so-and-so, this person, that person, for spreading ideas like this. And the ghulat, they weren't just spreading these words. They weren't just spreading this message. No, they would fabricate narrations. Wow. They would come to the companions of Imam Al-Baqir. They would take their books of narrations. They would put in these books fabricated narrations and then pass them back. This book, for example, belonged to Zurara. This book would spread. People, all of a sudden, they see that in this book, Zurara says that you don't need to pray. You could rely on the love of Ahlul Bayt. For example,
yeah.
This was very dangerous. They would fabricate law, and they would fabricate narrations. It's as if the companions of Ahlul Bayt had said this.
Wow.
So Imam Al-Baqir had to face this problem and try to bring an end.
Just like Ali ibn Talib, when he met the people
who were ghulat during the days of Imam Ali, and there were ghulat at the days of Imam al-Baqir, and there were ghulat during the days of Imam al-Sadiq.
Mm-hmm.
Imam al-Baqir was not able to eradicate them.
Mm-hmm.
They continued to the days of Imam al-Sadiq. Mm-hmm. Proof of this is that we see from the narrations of Imam al-Sadiq, Imam al-Sadiq also tried to combat al-ghulat.
Yeah.
And there were several, their leaders. Imam al-Baqir tried, Imam al-Sadiq also tried to combat them.
Mm-hmm.
This was a major problem that put Shi'ism in danger.
Definitely.
This danger, this inside danger, was not less than the outside danger, was danger from foreign agents. Because they gave a reason for the Khulafa to say, see, these are the Shia.
Yeah.
They're not Muslim.
Yeah.
They don't practice the Quran. The Quran says pray, fast. The Shia say that all you need is love of Imam Sadiq.
Yeah.
All you need is love of Imam Baqir. So they added salt to the injury.
Wow.
The Ahlul Bayt were already attacked. The Ghulat were giving a reason for the Khulafa to attack the Ahlul Bayt even more.
Wow.
So this was a major obstacle for
mm-hmm.
a major challenge for Imam Baqir to deal with. And he did. He did. But it was Imam Sadiq who came and continued the journey of Imam al-Baqir
alayhi salam. Now, it's safe to say as a conclusion that there was a personal agenda that motivated them.
Absolutely. There was a personal agenda to underscore Ahlul Bayt.
Ahsantum Sayyidina. I would like to thank you very much for joining us tonight.
My pleasure.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala aid you as well as the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam to continue spreading the knowledge of Ahlul Bayt.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for joining us in this series.
My pleasure.
Allah salam kum. Now, respected viewers, thank you very much for tuning in. It's important to pick up the important lessons which can be derived from the life of Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam, especially in the way how to increase our spirituality, at the same time increase our ability to spread the knowledge of Ahlul Bayt in the same way Imam al-Baqir and the Ahlul Bayt did. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.